今天洗澡都没洗，妹妹都进入了我当过多了那个休息间，现在我们不想说完的。各地龙子比说那么多，最近那个新的龙子节，人们就是用的家动物，都是他也想到说完的。今我跟那土著土著讲，就不离我这个国家嘛。感情就过去，别点亲戚，悄悄领个小老说完的。我们休息间不让多，都是你闺女你老公就跟我说的吧，在为了没小老说完的。Manjuru nage ta danya besim jen nam jen na jela na meba yang da wa zobe sanje ju kumbarun bu jine jang to bar zang di yi jitu san yu jitu tuk jine lepa sembar na mura shu On front of all the great senior lamas and all our dear friends here and ladies and gentlemen, in some way, enjoy to speak with you and discuss. But in some way, it is a very, very embarrassing for me. Today I am a little bit nervous, you see. I really don't know what to say. As we say in Buddhism, Kulunda Kunju, as His Holiness the Dalai Lama always speaks, shaping the motivation is very, very important, very significant. Before we start a session, practice, puja, ceremony, anything, or maybe individual practice, we must first work on shaping our motivation. Our motivation works like a glass container that can contain and keep water and drinks, so forth. So, in order to keep such liquid, important liquid, we need first the container to be perfect, or maybe I would say usable. So first our mind, the motivation has to be cleansed, changed, analyzed, or swiped to remove all the negative bits and pieces and the faults. The thoughts, the daily life thoughts, the useless thoughts and so forth. To first clean that away so that we have a good base to contain the nectar of Buddha Dharma, teachings of Buddha. So today, the main subject we will be discussing on is the first teaching of Buddha, the Lord Buddha. The first teaching of Lord Buddha was the Four Noble Truths. Four Noble Truths. Or we say in Tibetan or Chöke, Denpaji ki Chungkors. Now, what is the Four Noble Truths? The first thing what Buddha said to his followers, he said, there is suffering in this world. That is the first one. Secondly, Buddha said, the cause of the suffering, the root of the suffering. Third is the cessation. And the fourth is the path of liberation, or we can call it awakening or enlightenment. Yes, enlightenment. So first thing, suffering. Or they say in the Sanskrit, dukkha. But if you really think carefully, in the Sanskrit meaning of dukkha, it actually does not mean suffering. Dukkha literally means discontentment, unhappiness, dissatisfaction, That, so it is a more of a subtle meaning. Suffering is a more sort of a substantial or sort of solid meaning, or maybe more aggressive. So literally, if you translate from the, how do we say, Sanskrit to English, it actually means sort of discontentment or unhappiness. So what does that supposed to mean? That is unhappiness. What is suffering? What is unhappiness? And how many times do we have to go through suffering in our life? From the day we are born to the day we die, how many times do we suffer? Countless numbers of suffering, countless numbers of phases or different stages and different circumstances of unhappiness, discomfort, sadness, problematic, complication, and so forth. So think about it, you see, how many unhappiness come through in our life. So in suffering itself, Buddha said there are three stages. Dungal ki dungal, suffering upon suffering. Jurvi dungal, changeable suffering. And chabadusiji dungal. Chabadusiji dungal, I don't know what you call that in English. Maybe suffering with the cause, I believe. First, let's talk about changeable suffering. Changeable suffering, it is like an example. If somebody is very, very cold and he starts putting on warm clothes and then drinking hot water and then putting a fire, and then he thinks that is the pleasure of hot or maybe warmth. But when the hot is too much, then it's too heat. Too much of heat. And that is discomfort, unhappiness. Then he needs to remove his clothes or maybe go outside, inhale some fresh air to cool down the heat. So you see that in that second, this change, right away change, little bit of a pleasure, so-called pleasure we create our mind, in 1 second became suffering, became discomfort, became unhappiness. Sometimes we have been told that we are getting a promotion and we don't get a promotion, or sometimes our business is not going well, it is going well, or we are losing money, we are losing family, we are losing loved ones, we are losing our friends, our status, our name, our fame, and then we change this problem and confusion and problematic. So we have that actually every single day in our life. And then now, suffering upon suffering, the second one. What does suffering upon suffering mean? Is it when you are going into the face of such a strong suffering, maybe you have an accident, not a severe accident, maybe a small accident, and you are having the difficulty of that pain and tragedy, the trauma, physical pain and so forth. On top of that, maybe the doctor tell you you have some health issue, you have a cancer or some sort of a tumor or some problems. Just after 1 second you get another build up suffering, discontentment, unhappiness. That is suffering upon suffering. And now the third one. I am not correctly sure about the third one, chabadusiji dungal. I think it means suffering with condition, but I'm not correct with that. So you can check and correct me, no problem. Buddha said, there is suffering. Second teaching, Buddha said, the root and the cause
or the suffering.
We human beings have a tendency to blame it on something. Oh, why are you suffering? Or is it because of my life? Or because of my job? Because of my life? Because of my family? Because of my children? Because of my wife? Because of my husband? Or because of my parents? Is this something we like to blame on? But actually, it is not because of that. Simply, it's because what is happening inside, in our mind. Now you say nowadays people are getting very big mixed up. So such as soul. Nowadays many people are using soul. And you ask somebody, what is soul? They will say, it's my mind, it's sem. It is not your sem, it is not your mind. Soul is not a language we use in Buddhism. What do we use? Mind. Mind is the only thing that we use. Of course, there is some things called life force or life energetic or something. But the main point is mind. Mind is the base. Mind is the base of everything. The controller of everything. Where does the cause of this unhappiness, sadness start? Okay, now I will make it a true partition. Buddhist point of view and practical level. So let's first go to the Buddhist point of view. Buddhist point of view, we say suffering is caused by the three poisons. Tuksum, Nyimon Tuksum, or Nyimon Gisen, as we say in Tibetan, or Chukye. What is the three poison? I say, attachment, anger, and ignorance. You see in the paintings nowadays, a snake, and a pig, and a rooster. The snake represents what we call anger, the pig represents ignorance, and the rooster represents desire. And sometimes it's a little bit embarrassing. Why? Because I'm born in not the Western astrology, but Eastern. Chinese, Tibetan, Bhutanese, so forth. Whatever you like to call it. In the Eastern astrology, I'm born in the rooster year. So when some people don't know who I am, and they ask me, which year are you born in? And then I say, oh, I'm born in the rooster year. And then they think, oh, maybe you have a lot of desire. Well, I think that's very true. I do have a lot of desire. But I'm not proud of it. It's a big problem. It's a big, big issue. And in the Western, I am a, thank God, I am a Cancer. How ironic. So when people ask me, what are you in astrology here? I have to say, I am a Cancer. And some people jump from their seat. And they give me all of this lecture of, oh, how sad, you must see a doctor. And I'm like, oh, excuse me, I'm not cancer patient. I'm just cancer as a, you know, that crab. I don't know why people can't call it a crab. They have to call it a cancer. Really, really disappointing for me so much. Yeah, so in the Buddhist point of view, you say negative emotions. Of course, the three poison is the base, it's root. But then we talk about negative emotions. Emotions and thoughts that we have not able to control, have not been able to stabilize, and have not been able to, how to say, optimize. Cleanse, we are not cleansed. When you really think about it, it's actually very true. How is it true is that when you think carefully, to yourself. And every single day, problems that come out to us is actually every single thing about our me, I, myself, discomfort, discontentment, unhappiness. It's not to do with other people, it's not to do with anybody. It's really nothing to do with anybody. It's really nothing to do with any environment or atmosphere. It is only simply to do with our mind, our problematic, lazy, untrained mind. Now, when you look at it into a practical level, let's keep it aside, the Buddhist perspective. Now, when you think about the practical perspective, it's a very sort of rubbish in some ways, I think. Maybe I am mistaken. But I think practical reason is a little rubbish. Why? Because everything is to blame. Or why you're suffering, or is it something to do with that and this and that? There's a whole list of it. So there's not really a base, stable base to that. It's just something we have to grab on, something we have to pinpoint. So we just blame it on everything we can. Oh, why does the water doesn't taste good? Because the water is old. Or why does my chair doesn't feel good? Because it's so soft. And why does the carpet look so black? Because it's so dirty, and all of this. Oh, why does my clothes doesn't fit well? Because it's so difficult, whatever. Yeah. It's all because we blame on something. Now the interesting part is that the practical level and the Buddhist level combine. It integrates. How does it integrate? Because first, having just a simple meaning, of course we live in the practical world, practical thoughts, practical perspective. That is something I don't have to explain. But when we come to the Buddhist point of view, on that practical level, when we put the Buddhist perspective, the Buddhist training, the Buddhist knowledge, it gives us the opportunity to see things more clear. It actually makes us more optimistic. Because we people are very pessimistic. I am so sorry to say, especially you Bhutanese people, are truly pessimistic. You watch the TV in some village area, some old man talks, oh, Nalu Chu, Minu Lam, Minu Lo, Minu Naka, Chi, Mese. Don't never appreciate what you have. Always complain, complain, and complain. When are you going to start complaining? Stop complaining. I don't know why. If there were like a God, if there were a creator, he must be making a good joke. He must be creating everybody, and he's like, okay, now I have some leftover of this pessimistic. Let me give it to the Bhutanese people. You people take that. And you happily take it with so much of pride. And you show it off. I am a man or woman or whatever, with full pessimistic. It's even written on my head. So great. How amazing. It's very true, actually. We're very pessimistic. Very unappreciative. We never appreciate any single thing. Now the world is changing, you see. The modernization is becoming so strong. But Guru Rinpoche, Guru Penma Sambhava, said in the short katam, Dhamma katam, you see there's a longer version, the shorter version. In the shorter version, in one of the prophecies, he says, Dunam minjur minam jurvatams. What is that supposed to mean? It means time does not change. People change. First, I did not believe that. You know, I don't agree with that. It does not matter if Guru Rinpoche says, it does not matter if Lord Buddha says, I did not agree with that. How does it change? How does time doesn't change and people change? I mean, if time didn't change, we would have still lived like the caveman. Very simple thing. Fetching food, water, fire. We will not have anything more sophisticated, more education. We'll be really living in a very simple world, very simple life. Do you even see nowadays anybody writing letter to anybody? You don't see anybody. You tell somebody, do you write to your friends? They will laugh at your face. And they call names at your face saying, oh, what are you, some prehistoric barbarian or what, huh? I'm not a barbarian, it's just that I like the art, you see. Writing to a friend, it is an amazing thing. You write, you have so much of effort, time, then you draw little pictures around, maybe flowers or birds, or you draw maybe like a water stream, or you draw the atmosphere that you see from your house, and then you start telling very nice things to your friend. Passion and art. Nowadays, what do we do? We just say, oh yeah, I'm writing to my friend, and we do, finish. Worse than that, people write on the text, you know? And nowadays, oh my God, when people write on the phone, there's this new lineage of writing, such as like when they write things like, I see you tomorrow. It's like an I and a C and a U and a number two. Oh my God, what kind of language is that? I mean, thank you, the great land of England gave us the opportunity to learn English, proper English. I don't mean no offense to the Americans, you did a lot. But I prefer the English. I think that's a more of an elegant way. And sometimes some of my friends here, they send me a letter and I'm like, oh my God, what is that supposed to mean? Then I have to write them back, what is that supposed to mean? And then they're like, okay, this is supposed to mean that. And I mean, so like that, you see. Human beings, we become very, very, very selfish. I don't want to talk good about myself. I really don't want to. When some people tell me, oh, Rinpoche, no, I can't see you because you're so busy. You're a busy, busy man. I don't want to say I'm busy. Because it's like I'm boasting also. I'm so busy. I don't have time for you. I don't like to talk about that. Yes, I have work. I have a lot of work to do, a lot of study, many work to do. But I like to keep quiet. No, I don't like to tell people, you see. And people want to see me. I want to see them too. Because I miss this whole interaction of each other, you see. Seeing each other's face, talking. But unfortunately, I can't do that in Bhutan. When everybody's head is nearly touching on the floor, and then the only answer I get is lasso. It's a very, you know, in some way irritating. A bunch of people come to see me and they sit and then we give tea. And then like, oh, tari nam shinam sim lishim du mo, lasso. Tari ani chap chandi zum ji du mo, lasso. Na lo kam chi na, lasso. Na alu kam chi yoga, lasso. Na ming kashima, lasso. You see, when I get to that kind of situation, how am I supposed to talk? And actually, there is a secret that lasso actually means. It's a very polite way, an indirect way to say, please shut up. It's a very true. When you talk to somebody, they're saying something, and he just says, lasso. And then you're like, it's a very irritating. I hate that. Whoever created this lasso word, I will love to talk with him, a private conversation. That's why you see, in my life, sometimes I have nobody to talk to so much, you see. It's very true. So that's why I have no choice. I go into my bathroom, I lock the door, and then I talk to myself. But I am very, very fortunate. In my life, I have many people who are amazingly great to me. So I can share with them and talk to them. But sometimes it's a little complicated to have a normal conversation. So anyone here in this room think people try to say lasso to you is not a good reason. As I was saying before, how we integrate practical level perspective and Buddhist perspective is that once you will understand this when you practice Buddhism. I'm sure you all practice Buddhism a lot. When you start practicing Buddhism, you start realizing that every difficult thing you go through in your life is actually all because of you, all due to yourself, all due to your mind. To say, hey, oh, maybe my problems are not caused by other people. Is not caused by the environment, is not caused by the you see, atmosphere, Koryuk atmosphere. I really think it's caused by our inner mind that is not being tamed well. Maybe you're going a shopping mall or somewhere, or maybe a market, and you're buying something and the things that you want to buy are not there yet. It's maybe on the way or something, and then you get agitated and you get angry and you start scolding and complaining to the dealer or the shopkeeper. But when you start realizing through the Buddhist perspective, then you still think, oh, maybe it's not like that. I should not be blaming others. I should start to realize I should be more patient, more calm. Whatever I want to buy, whatever I'm looking for, it is on the way, it will come. So you see that automatically comes down. We appreciate, we understand, our knowledge expands. If you do understand what I'm saying, you see our knowledge expands. Then we go through a little bit difficult time, some pressure of life, family, so forth. We automatically think, oh, yes, I have some difficulties, but no worry, I will face them, I will look at them as a new start, a new rebirth in my life. I will look at it as a, idea or a knowledge to me. I would not look at it like a threat or difficult thing. Let me look at it in a more positive way. So you see, automatically mind become more vast, more wide. See all the corners and everything. Right now we only see like this. Start realizing Buddhist perspective, knowledge, wisdom, it makes us see all around, the whole picture. What is the root of suffering? It is the untamed, reckless, emotionalized mind of ours. So that is the second thing Buddha said, the cause of suffering. And then now, thirdly, the cessation. The Buddha said there is a cessation towards this suffering. Cessation means like a obscure or clean that away, transform that into knowledge. Learn through this. Seeing something more than we usually see, learning through that, taking that as a new knowledge and idea. Opening our eyes wide open to the whole knowledge, looking at the full picture, the whole image comes to the point of cessation, knowing the way out of suffering. And of course, the last Buddha said, Gopidemba, the path to liberation. Out of the ocean of samsara and to enlightenment, or what we call the awakening mind. If I give you a very simple example, when I was quite young, maybe I think 7 years old, I believe, in my home, my root teacher, Shepchi Ramjam Rinpoche, maybe some of you know, we were talking about it, just a normal thing. And suddenly in the morning, I was drinking this cold milk somebody gave me. And after a few moments I drank this cold milk, I started to have a very strong pain, a gastritis feeling in my stomach or abdomen. So at that time, my root teacher Ramjan Rinpoche gave me a medicine, two medicines. And I had to eat one or another with a glass of warm water. And he said, that was the first teaching I got from him on the Four Noble Truths, what we are discussing today. He said, first there is suffering, because you drank a glass of cold water, and after this you had a lot of gastritis and severe pain in the stomach caused by the cold milk and so forth. That is the pain, suffering, discomfort. Second, the root of that pain in my stomach, drinking unpasteurized cold milk in a very cold weather. Third, cessation. Aha, there is a way out. It's not the end. There is a way out. What is the way out? Take the medicine and with the warm water. So I took, Mbuchi gave me two medicine. I took a glass of warm water. Immediately the pain went away. After that, the fourth one, Gopidemba, the path of liberation. So through this knowledge, we understand from now onwards, never drink cold milk that is unpasteurized in the cold weather. You see, that is the knowledge we gain, so that we will never have to suffer in that way. So that was the first teaching he gave me, and I never forget that. It is very helpful every day when I think about it. So actually, when we really think about cause of suffering, samsara, or the three poisons, or what we call untamed mind, as the great master or scholar Tilopa once gave advice to his student Naropa, and he said, but now we mention Shimbiching, Shemba Chuchi Naropas. And what does that mean? In this world, the one essence, the one root essence that binds you to the suffering of the ocean of samsara, ocean of unconditional suffering, unconditional problem, is not your thoughts, is not the thought. Nawa is thought, you see, is not the thought. But it is the clingingness, it is the attachment that you have to the world of samsara, to the worldly issues that you require. Shemba chuchi narobas. If you want to be released from the ocean of samsara, want to be freed ultimately from the ocean of pain, suffering, and difficulty, first, clean, put an end to the clingingness, then you will be freed. That is my advice for you. So, this word is so amazing. Maybe you mentioned Shimpi Ching, Shimpa Chuch Narubas. So such an amazing word. Really with the deep meaning. But the thoughts are not the ones who attack us. The thoughts are not ones who give us difficulty, pain. It is the second one that comes. The second disease, the second, what I like to call poison. Clingingness, attachment. That is the problem. You see, it comes with the thought. When we look at something, we first have the thought, and then secondly we have the attachment, the clingingness, you see. That's where all the problems starts to begin. Starts seeing all the rich people. All the people who drive Land Cruiser, four-story building in Thimphu Town, every weekend to Bangkok, holiday, going to a five-star hotel, lunch and dinner. Ah, mama, what's that? I'm a semi-jikta atatira gose. So we aim for that, yeah? We see that. It is not like you see, it's okay, good for him, fine. It's like, oh, I want that, I want that. And then we hunt for that. You see, we hunt for that. We try to get that, we grab that, we stuck to that. Then we live our whole life. And then we become old, dying, and then we're like, oh my God, what did I do in my life? I wasted all my life trying to hunt my so-called dream, desire, attachment. And now look what happened to me. I did not do one single moment of goodness to others. I did not help anybody. I created more problems and then now I'm going to die. That happen. It does happen. Maybe I'm boring you all with my stupid word. So I see everybody very bored. And then everybody looking at the time and they're looking at me, supposedly saying, oh, it's nearly time finish. But let me tell you something. I don't give a shit. All right? I don't care what time it is. All right? I'm very sorry you came to this talk. Oh, like, oh my God, is Kenzi Yangtze talking? Let's all go. But it's not going to be so pleasant. It's not like what you thought. I'm going to talk about all flower and sunshine and beauty and whatever. Early time, Egyptian time, Greek, Romans, the ancient Romans, or the Mongolians, Chinese, the Europeans, so forth. Every land, every country had the worst way of torturing people, to make them suffer and to tell the truth, or tell them the knowledge or the secret that they are trying to look for. But if I tell you a secret, the real torturer does not need iron and sharp tools to torture people. A real torturer needs the sharp mind. You cannot have a sharp tool to torture people. You need to have the sharp mind to torture the people. So that's why all the lamas nowadays are actually a very good torturer. They know how to torture you very well. They know your weak point, they know where to squeeze, where to push, where to pinch, where to poke, where to rip, and then we all scream and oh my God and cry and die and whatever, yeah. Or we still want to come back to the teacher. We still like, oh my God, my Tsevi Lama, whatever, yeah. Why? Because teachers are gifted with the torture system. I am not talking about myself. I'm not a very good torturer. I've done that many times and all the time I failed. I became the victim, not the other people I tried to torture. But actually, as human beings, we are always torturing ourselves 24 hours. Why? We have doubts, we have confusion, we have desire, attachment, anger, every single day conflicting into ourselves, circling. It's torture. Nonetheless, it is extremely torturous, extremely painful. It is. You get embarrassed with your own self. Not because of other people, but because of your own self. Why? Look, we're torturing ourselves. Every single day, the negative mind is torturing us, 24 hours. And I know you may think I'm rude and immature and very spoiled or, I don't know, very egoistic. It's very true. I am spoiled. I have a lot of ego. I have a lot of self-issue. I have a lot of problem. I'm not a perfect. You see, but because of my great teacher, because of the Buddha Dharma, really helped me to understand my real nature, my true self, open myself and understand who I am, learn and improve, make mistake and improve. I have one thing to declare. I really think that samsara is a bitch. I am very sorry. It's very true. Truth should always be spoken, no matter how it sounds like. And I'm sure there's so many people here who try to act so professional. Oh, I'm so professional. Oh, what is this a teacher talking about? He's talking about all disgusting things. Oh, so rude. Oh, my God. Oh, I'm so sorry that I look so imperfect, because I am imperfect. But at least I'm trying to tell you that what is imperfect, so that we all learn how to make it perfect. Not to decrease, but increase. Better and better. I'm so-called a teacher, master, Rinpoche, wish-fulfilling jewel. That's how you say it in English. But I have so much of dirty thought. See, I sit on a throne, I do puja or ceremony. When I see beautiful ladies and girls pass by, I'm like, oh my God. Where have you been in my whole life? And some people have even told me, you know, Rinpoche, whatever you do is no problem. When you give blessing, if it's normal people, you just do it like that. If it's some woman or some lady, you do it like this. And all. It's not acceptable. What to do? But no problem, yeah. In Bhutan, when you wear especially kira and all of that, you know, covers everything, no? So you don't actually see anything. So, yeah, that takes care of that issue. So that's why, you know, sometimes I really think to myself, sitting on this high golden throne, all my monks and lamas and tukus and kempo, and all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, you know, watching above us, giving us guidance, and then I'm like, oh my God, you know. Doing so-called mantra and then thinking about desire all the time. It's so horrible. I feel very ashamed sometimes, really, you know. I feel very ashamed. I'm serious. I'm really shameful. What kind of a lama am I when I have so much of negative emotion? When I can't even control my own mind? Who am I to tell you people what to do? I'm nobody. So disgusting. Our mind, so disgusting. In that moment of time, I just leave practice and I pray to my guru and I think about my teacher and pray to him and think, please, what is wrong with me? You see, that's why when I look at my previous life movies, there's one recently opened, Brilliant Moon, I don't cry, but I get very depressed watching that, because I am nothing like him. I mean, he's like the sun, you know, shining over all darkness, and I am like the darkness shining all on the sun. In our preliminary practice, Hundo, or in the calling the Lama from afar, Lama Jangbu. He says, Lama Sanji, Lama Chu, Tijin Lama Gundindi, Kunji Sebo Lama, Lama Nama Changsalu. The Lama is the Buddha, the Lama is the Dharma, and the Lama is the Sangha. The only one that I will take refuge from this life to the second and to decades will only be you, the one and only Lama that I pray to. The jewel of my heart, the wish-fulfilling jewel. These words really mean a lot. They really help you to the most darkest times you have in your life. When you have difficulty in your life, always pray to your Lama. Don't need to think about Lama teaching sometimes. I'm not telling you not to think. I'm just saying rest your mind. Relax your mind and think about the Lama's graciousness, compassion, loving kindness, the Lama's, you know, outer appearance. And think about whatever the Lama do. It's all for Buddha Dharma, all to serve the sentient beings, all to teach us ignorant living sentient beings to know how to live a life, to know how to be liberated from this ocean of samsara, to open our eyes to see the whole image. Think about that again and again. Don't just say japsu chiu. It's a waste of time. Really think your teacher. Because I see nowadays many people don't respect the teacher, don't have devotion to the teacher. They say, oh, japsu chiu. What is japsu chiu? What Chansalo? What Zaiwe Lama? What Root Guru? You don't even have devotion to your teacher. Why do you even say that? First, learn the baby steps. See the Guru as pure. Understand the Guru. Whatever the Guru does has meaning towards you, towards all of us. Learn that. Understand that. So really important. You may not have that opportunity again. One teacher, of course, my root teacher, Devi Trishan Bache, I was not able to spend so much time with him because I was very young and so forth. One of the most important teachers in my life is Jabji Ramjaram Bache. And, you know, to me, he is everything of my life. He is like a father, a friend. And sometimes I really hate myself because I like disobey him, I don't listen to him, I get a little bit disappointed over what things he says to me, and I think, who am I to get disappointed, to don't disobey? I am nobody. Rather than that, I should be so thankful and so grateful. I have met such a teacher in my life. And that teacher cares for my life until the death. Whatever simple thing, he will take care of. And a teacher never gives up on you. If you give full your life, your devotion, your trust, your faith, teacher will take care of you from the most simple thing to the most complicated things. One thing I really live up to living, or happy to live, is really because of my teacher, Ramjaram Bache. If he is not there in my life, I don't think it would be so meaningful to me as now it is. The teachers that I go to receive teachings and empowerments, my English teacher, my cook, everything. I am so, so grateful. I really feel so sad sometimes. I think I'm such a useless guy. And it's all because of my previous life. Previous life's blessing and gratefulness. So I always promise to myself, even though my life is very complicated and difficult, I always promise myself, I will do something, at least to serve Buddha Dharma and to serve my teacher's wish. I don't need name, fame, you know, whatever. That is not important. What is important is to serve my responsibility and to serve my duty as the most, to the most fullest. This connection that you have with previous should always flow like a, you know, river stream that never stops. And it's a big knowledge I learned when they tell me stories of my predecessor, how he used to talk and how he used to be very kind and loving. Care for each and every person in this world, no matter who they are, rich, poor, famous, whatever. Give teaching, give time. Amazing. That is a true Buddha. That is a true Guru Mahārāja. One thing I want to tell you all, and this is kind of important, but it's a little bit painful, is that I think nowadays our society is getting really mixed up with all kinds of weird things, all kinds of weird traditions. It's important to keep one tradition, not to mix. You see, some people I see, they're trying to act like Westerners, they're trying to act like Americans and English and whatever, European and French, but you're losing your own tradition. Know who you are. If you are a Bhutanese, you're Nepalese, you're Indian, or you're Tibetan, know who you are, remember who you are, and always keep that with you. Because one day or another, that tradition that you have with you, if that is lost, and lost everything. If that is not lost, nothing is lost. Our culture, our customs, if that is kept, is same as keeping. If that does not exist in ourself, in our bloodstream, in our society, in ourselves, you have nothing. You are a sheep without a shepherd. Nothing, no up, no down, no where, nothing. But like a roaming around, with no tradition, with no dignity. We need to have dignity, we must have our tradition. It's very important. Never deny that. It's one thing I want to tell you. And don't mix things up. That's very important. I believe it's His Majesty Jimmy Singhi Wangchu, the fourth Drukgyalpo's birthday. I always make aspiration of, because of my previous life, I always make aspiration, may Chinsa Rinpoche's blessing and guidance be always with His Majesty, and may he live long, and may we all remember what he did, you know, especially you people, remember what he did and what he contributed to this nation. And I'd really like to, you know, even dedicate this to one of the most beloved Queen Grandmother, Jaim Chembo, Ajikisan Chudun Wanchu. It was like a grandmother to me, a very loving kindness, non-changing from previous life to now. And I'm not saying this to make it sound pretty and to brag about it, but I want to speak the truth. And she is the one queen I ever seen in my life that really contributed so much and dedicated her whole life to Buddha Dharma, preserving Buddha Dharma, preserving Vajrayana. And not in this, not only in this nation, not only in this country, but for all. So I really make aspiration, may she live long, and may everyone, I don't know how many people really know how much she did. May we all know how much she contributed and dedicated to herself, to this nation, and to prolong Vajrayana, to prolong Buddha Dharma. May that flourish as much as far as possible. And most importantly, may the Buddha Dharma roar like the lion's roar and make it be heard throughout the whole world corner. The Buddhism, Buddha Dharma, will live on and prolong and exist eons and eons of lifetime. And may that benefit all sentient beings who may need and require the help and guidance. So, Thank you very much.